Amen. I want to talk to you tonight about something. It's kind of simple, but how many was here last week? How much love do we need in the ministry? How much love do we need in our hearts? Now, this is going to offend some of you because you're going to take it out of context when I say this. You're going to completely take it out of context. I know before I say it, but I'm going to say it anyway. How many of y'all know I'm that way? I'm going to say it anyways. There's a baptism far greater than the Holy Spirit. I know a whole lot of people preach. Now, I preach the Holy Ghost. You can't get saved without Him. You can't do nothing without Him. But the church is in dire need of a baptism of compassion. Because He said, "Thou know that we're His disciples by the way we love one another." But not only how we love one another. See, it's all right to hate sin, but we shouldn't be hating the sinners. And I see so much anger in a lot of Christians because they don't want people around them. And I'm going to say it this way, sin differently than they do. Because we all come short of the glory of God. Amen. But listen, listen. Don't be so quick to clap because the Bible's... But coming short of the glory of God and willfully sinning is two different ball games. Amen. The Bible says we shouldn't sin. Amen. But if you got your Bibles, turn with me to John chapter 10. Because I want to talk to you. Who do you say He is? And I'm reading from the NLT, honey. That's why I didn't give you no Bible verses. But it's John chapter 10, starting at verse 22. And we don't have an NLT on our computer back there yet. But it ain't that much off. If you want to pull it up, I'll give you a little bit. Man, I'm slow. Golly. I remember the first time I was in a church that had all that stuff. And I said, gave the verse, I said, "Y'all shout amen." And everybody shouted amen real quick. I said, "Man, I ain't seen nobody look down to turn them a bunch of liars. Man, they ain't looked at their Bible." Big old Jumbotron behind me. And I said, "Great, day in the morning." Me and technology just don't get along. Hallelujah. John 10, why am I in verse chapter 9? Ain't going to work. Starting at verse 22. It was now winter, and Jesus was in Jerusalem at the time of Hanukkah, the festival of dedication. He was in the temple walking through the section known as Solomon's Colonnade. The people surrounding Him asked, "How long are you going to keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly." Then Jesus replied, "I have already told you, and you don't believe me. The proof is the work I do in my Father's name. But you don't believe me because you are not my sheep. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they will never perish." Amen, amen, amen. "No one can snatch them away from me, for my Father has given them to me. And He is more powerful than anyone else. No one can snatch them from the Father's hand. The Father and I are one." Verse 31. Once again, the people picked up stones to kill Him. And Jesus said, "At my Father's direction, I have done many good works. For which one are you going to stone me?" Verse 33. They replied, "We're stoning you not for any good work, but for blasphemy. You're a mere man, claim to be God." Who do you say He is? See, So many people, and I say this a lot lately, I guess it's in my spirit right now. So many people get saved just to keep from going to hell, and that's a good reason, I reckon. But I'm talking about being in a relationship with Jesus, because it's so much more than being saved. People get saved and all of a sudden they get comfortable, and a lot of that's caused lack of Holy Ghost preaching, and a lot of it's because people are scared to let loose and let that unseen, that you ain't seen this God yet, control your life. That's a pretty big step to say, hey, God, I'm letting you be in charge. I'm going to trust you with everything in my life. God, I'm going to trust these words that are in. Because see, we physically not have shook his hand yet. We physically have not met him yet. And yet, these people, the priest knew who he would be. And all the stuff he was doing, yet they was blinded. They did not want to accept, because they thought their king was coming with a big crown, a big army, this fancy robe on fancy horse and chariots, and thought he's going to roll into town and take over. But yet the prophets knew that he was going to be born of a virgin in a small getaway place, and he didn't show up with all the pageantry and stuff. And so my question is, when you got saved, he still didn't show up that way. So who do you say he is? Many in church will say, he's my Savior, and that's good. But who do you say he is? Is he just a God out somewhere? Is it just a fairy tale? Or are you just hanging around just in case that book is real? So who do you say he is? See, the people of the time, they like the works. And so many times I believe Christians today, they like someone to come and pray for them to get healed, get set free of whatever. They appreciate all of that. But who do you say he is? Because I'm going to get to a point here. When you finally say who he is, you should be a mirror image of who he says he is. Boy, some of you didn't get that. We're supposed to be his children. Now, any of y'all would have had the privilege of knowing my daddy, my dad was a lot bigger than me. But I had a lot of characteristics of my daddy. I mean, I did things the way my dad. I thought the way my dad thought. I'd approach things the way my dad did, because he raised me. My dad was everything to me for a lot of my life. But we, as children of God, our Heavenly Father, who do we say he is? Because so many times, and I'm guilty of this too. I mean, I might point one finger, but I got three of them pointing back at me, so you're in good company. But who do you say is when we're supposed to be a light in a dark place, and yet we're partakers of the dark? Who do we say he is then? We as Christians have been given a great commission, go into all the world and preach this gospel. What gospel? Jesus Christ. Granted, we can use Genesis to Revelation, but Jesus is the name that needs to be lifted up. But if you really don't know who he is, how are you going to tell about who he is? If you really don't know him, if you really, you know, getting saved is fantastic, but it's so much more than getting saved. Attending church is great. You need to. The Bible says, forsake not the assemblies of yourself, and even more so when you know the end's around and we're in the end time. And that's all great. Paying tithes is fantastic. Putting an offering is fantastic. Singing is fantastic. But who do you say he is? You can speak with your mouth and say he's somebody, but do they see Christ in you? They'll say, who do they see? Who do you say is? Who do you let him shine through as? Well, it's going to be a tight. I'm going to drag this wagon or bust. But let me tell you something. Jesus Christ, when he come, and then we just got through the Easter season or whatever you want to call it. You know he bled and died. He got up. The crucifixion paid the price for our sins. But if he didn't get up, his resurrection was ever as important. By him getting up in layman's terms, it was God the Father's way of saying, amen, I accept it. Now get up and live. Amen. We as Christians, we have to get to the point that we let
Jesus shine through us, because that's when you really begin to say who he is to you. Boy, some of you are hanging on here. See, Mike Price, everybody knows who I am. But that can't do nothing for you. I can send you to some places that might get you stopped or killed. But Jesus, all I am is a servant. All I am is a messenger boy of this word. But he is the King of glory. He was the Word that was made flesh and dwelt amongst us. Because in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. He's always was before was. Are you listening to me? He didn't show up on the scene. Man, everybody's coughing. Now I'm coughing. Tag. Somebody else take it. But he didn't just show up that Christmas morn, if we want to say it that way. He was before was. Before the foundation of the earth. But we as Christians, when we say we are a child of God, we ought to be saying who he is. Who is he? Sure, he's our Savior. He's our King. Now let me tell you something. Let me preach here for a little bit. Back in biblical times, especially in the Old Testament, if you remember the story about Nehemiah, he went before King Z. I can't get a big fancy name, so it's King Z. You'll know who I'm talking about. But anyways, when he went before him bearing a cup of wine, his countenance, his personality, his heart was heavy, and he was broken. And the king could have you killed for that. Wouldn't it be nice if you had the authority to keep anybody with bad attitudes and old misery that don't come to you? Lord, wouldn't that be great? I'm dreaming. But listen, he went before him, and the king looked at him. He said, "Why is your countenance sad, man?" But Nehemiah had found favor with him. He said, "Why shouldn't my countenance be sad? Why shouldn't I be down in the dirt, man? My homeland, my walls are knocked down. The gates are burned up on my city. Why shouldn't I?" See, he knew who his God was. So he pleaded his heart before the king, and he found favor. And the king gave him permission to go back and start rebuilding the place. Are you listening to me? See, when you begin to know who God is in you, then you're going to walk in the favor of God. You do not walk in favor of God just because you say, "I walk in favor of God." That kind of preaching has been around way too long. It needs to go. But you've got to know who he is. But then here's the rest of the story. When you know who he is, people around you is going to know who he is in you. This ain't going to be a guess so type relationship. Are you a Christian? I love asking people, "Are you a Christian?" So many people, "Well, I'm this denomination. I go to this church." I could care less about that. Are you born again? Are you blood bought? Has your name been written in the Lamb's Book of Life? Are you born again? See, when you become born again, people notice it. They know there's something different about you. They're going to see the way the walk's different. They're going to see that your heart is different. You're going to act different to circumstances. Well, I don't know what's wrong with y'all so quiet, but I'm going to drag this thing on. Me and the boys ought to be tired. We the one went to the beach and rode back in a Methodist baptism all the way home. Y'all can get mad if you want to. It was more than a sprinkle, it was a downpour. My boots hadn't been so clean, I'm telling you, since they was new. And that's the inside of them. I'm telling you, whoever's praying for showers of blessings, they sure didn't explain it better. Say amen, boys. It was awful, wasn't it? Man, snake ran off and left us. He had that thing in the wind. See you later, bro. We're praying, brother. But I'm telling you who he is. When you understand that he's the Son of God, but then you've got to understand he's the Son of Man. Now let me ask you what the difference is. Do you know? Son of God is who, we know that part. But the Son of Man brings him back to the human nature of being our King. Are you listening to me? Because See, if we just portray him as a king, half the world won't receive him. Because, see, the gospel presents him the Son of God. So one presents him the Son of Man. The other presents him as a servant of God. Amen. And reason being, because he showed us the style of life that we should be living. We are the children of God, which makes us what? The sons of God. We're in the flesh, so we're the sons of men, right? But we also are servants of God, just like our Savior was, walking in the flesh. And let me tell you something. When you begin to understand who he is to you as a person, not to what I think, who he is to you, that personal relationship, then you begin to understand what's going to happen in your life. Because once you know who he is in your life, then the doors of blessing, then your health and your peace, and you have more power than you've ever dreamed of. But as long as you think he's some wise tale, some stargazer, or some plastic trinket on your dash, you're never going to experience the living the life that Jesus expected us to have. So who is God to you tonight? As long as we doubt in his word, check this out. As long as when we doubt in his word, you're really doubting in who he is. I've heard people, well, I'm a Christian, but I don't believe the whole Bible. Really? That's amazing. You don't believe the whole book, what part don't you believe? The Word was made flesh and dwelt amongst us. The Word was walking around. Listen, Jesus was before was, and I'm going to really mess up some of you dope. The Word was before was. He didn't fake it and make it when he was speaking his thing off his cuff. He knew what he was going to say because he was the Word. Oh, y'all ain't getting this. He knew who he was. He wasn't ashamed. And all these people was upset, not because of the work that he was doing, but they couldn't possibly believe some man walking around was truly the Son of God, yet the prophet said he was coming. We today have fell back into same sleep and slumber. We've heard for our whole life that Jesus is coming. Yeah, we know he's coming. If we truly believed who he was and that he truly was coming, then we would truly believe, this little light of mine. We would be quoting this scripture everywhere we go. Because we would not, if you truly had a baptism of compassion for mankind the way Jesus did, you wouldn't be so skeptical of getting mocked and laughed at. People says, does it bother you when people laugh at you? No, I laugh with them. Why? Because I get the last laugh. I got eternal life. I'm trying to teach them that, but they don't want it. But the thing of it is, knowing who he is, it's personal. See, not only is the Son of God a son of man, a servant, but he's your personal Savior. Oh, man. He died for all mankind. But within that realm of dying for all mankind, you've heard the old gospel song. While he was on the cross, you was on his mind. Sure enough, he was looking down at the pike of time. You know, there's going to be this biker that lived like hell, acted like hell, and hated everybody. I'm going to save his rear end. I'm going to go to the cross because he's going to need me one day. See, you got to put your name in there. So he becomes my personal God, my personal Savior, my personal healer, my personal word, my personal God, my personal guide, my personal defender. Everything in that book becomes personal to me because he personally wrote me a love story. Listen to me. When you understand who he is, then you have the ability then, because you struggle with things. You keep seem like you can't get victory, or you get victory for a few days and back into it. All this stuff. Listen, but once you know who he is.
Man, I lost my place and I had some more scripture to read. Help me, Lord. Well, number one, he gave me wisdom to put on glasses too. Amen, Walls. He said, they replied, we're stoning you not for any good work, but for blasphemy. You are mere man claiming to be God. And Jesus replied, it is written, your own scriptures, oh, this is going to get deep. Your own scriptures that God said to certain leaders of the people, I say you are God's, little G-O-D-S. And you know that the scriptures cannot be altered. So if those people who received God's message were called God's, little G-O-D-S, why do you call it blasphemy when I say I am the Son of God, big G-O-D? After all, the Father set me apart and sent me into the world. Don't believe me unless I carry out my Father's work. But if I do his work, believe in the evidence of the miraculous works I have done, even if you don't believe in me. Boy, it's deep. I have done even if you don't believe me, then you would know and understand that the Father is in me and I am in the Father. I believe in the Trinity. I don't see how you can study the Bible and do away with it. You got to deal with it sooner or later. I believe in God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost, not three separate gods. One God, that's just what I believe. Can't explain it no better than that. I just believe it. And if you can wrap your head around that part of it, then so you're not so confused. Who is God to you? He's God the Father. He's God the Son. He's God the Holy Ghost. He's the Word that was made flesh and walks amongst us. He's the Word that became flesh, came life. He become all things to us. He died for us. So who is he to you? See, you want to get somewhere with God, but you can't get past the realm that you personally don't know him in the flesh. And the sad part of that statement is, you shouldn't know him in the flesh. Oh my God, I just read it to you. I just read it to you. You may not met him in the flesh as shaking my hand, but believing for the miraculous works that he has done, and the first work that he did, that he died for your sins to wash away your sins, that's the greatest miracle of all. When you accept his salvation, he completely erases your past, never to remember it no more. So believe him on that count. But remember what he told Thomas after he got up, doubting Thomas. Well, I'm not going to believe unless I just see him. I'm going to put my finger in them holes. I just ain't going to believe. The first time we had the game operation, get it? Never mind. On the rabbit trail, shake the rabbit at me. But let me tell you something. But he looked at Thomas. You had to see me and believe, but how much greater is them that's not see me, yet they believe? What does that statement really mean? Because he looked at us afar off, and we're believing for past work that he done for a far-off future. Gosh, I wish you would get on board with this. Are you getting it or am I losing you? Amen. Are you getting it or am I losing you? Because here's the thing. Once you understand who God is, who is he? Who do you say he is? Once you're convinced and you know without a shadow of a doubt, I don't care what storm comes. I don't care what affliction shows up. I don't care what attack. You square up because you know who he is. Then you know who he is. Then the power of this Bible, the power of God lies within you. No, sir, cancer, I'm not taking it. No, sir, heart disease, I'm not buying into it. No, you say, no, I'm a child of God. I'm not living like a pauper. I'm not going to crawl around. I'm a child of God. I'm not believing in reports.
But see, we get sick, call the doctor. Ain't nothing wrong with doctor. I got some great doctors at the VA. I'm blessed because two of my doctors are Christians. And that's a rarity. Amen. But I'm saying, we have the authority. Our word should be so powerful. But it's not because we truly don't believe who he is. It's that simple. And I ain't trying to beat you up. I mean, I wrestle with stuff too. I mean, but the bottom line is, this is his spoken word. He cannot lie. What he says we can do, we should do it. The Bible says we'll lay hands on the sick and they shall what? Shall recover. Well, I'm going to do this. I don't know if anything's going to happen, Dan. You know, I know what that crazy book said. I think you ought to go see a doctor. That's the silliness of the church now. The original 12, they went out with the power of God. After the crucifixion, they went out. Peter, here's a man. Let's talk about Peter for a moment. I'm going to try to close. Here, I love Peter. He's just like us. He'd be a biker instead of a fisherman today. Hot-headed, foul-mouthed, ill, just everything. Even as a Christian, they come to get Jesus. Jesus didn't teach him to cut nobody with a sword. That's a sermon within itself, amen. But I'm going to tell you something. Afterward, though, Peter got the goods, man. Man, they walked by and the shadow went over the sick and they got healed. That's knowing who God is in your life. See, God, in Acts 10:34, he has no respect of person. What he's done in one's life, he'll do in others. We can be as close to God as we want to be if you want to put in the effort. If you really want to have an experience with God, fall in love with this Bible. Get to reading it, studying it. Don't put it down. Sleep with it. Get up. Take it to the bathroom with you. Sit on your phone. Read the stinking thing and find out what God's got for you. And then get a prayer life. Hey, God, let me talk to you here a little bit in the name of Jesus. I got to decrease so you can increase so I can do the very work that you've called me to do. It's that simple. But so let me ask you one more time. Who do you say he is? And go back to last week real quick. I'll save this for last. He is love. All the stories and all the sermons that was preached about how he got put on the cross. 90% of them was wrong. The Romans didn't crucify him. The Jews didn't crucify him. He come for that purpose. So he could spit out a word to tell us die. It's paid in full. Paid in full. How many of you bought a motorcycle and had to make payments and you finally get that title? Paid in full. Man, that Electric Glide's the only bike I've ever financed in my life, guys. It took me 400 years to get it paid for. Seemed like it. I ain't never getting rid of that bike. It's the only bike I've ever paid payments through a bank. I said, I'll never do it again. Let's go riding. I got to work more. I got to make a payment here coming up on this crazy thing. I got that thing paid in full. Still had to go to DMV to get my title, but I went over and got it. But see, Jesus paid it in full. And he sent you a registration. Oh, y'all ain't getting this. He sent you a registration that you can read that he paid it in full, that you belong to him because he's a God of love. He loved you while we were sinners. He died for us. So who do you say he is? If we ever going to shake this area up, we got to get genuine about loving people. It ain't always easy to love people. I'm going to hurt some of y'all's feelings. There's days I don't love y'all. I wake up hating the world. What's wrong with me? Steph said, you better go pray. You can't leave the house this way. Why can't I? Everybody else acts this way to me. I'm going to act this way to everybody today, God. I've had enough. Then my phone rings. Out of my, oh, I'm sorry, I'll pray with you. I'll be right there. You remember the cat story? Someone called me to pray for the cat. I don't like cats. My youngest daughter, she wants a cat, and I hate cats. They destroy paint jobs on motorcycles. They do. Yeah. And then they don't kill mice. Most of them fraidy cats, get it? But anyways. But we as Christians, when we know who God is, and when we say who He is, then we'll be saying who we believe He is. Then we'll be saying who we are because of Him, that He lives within inside of us, and His words are our words. I get chuckled when I see someone post some of my phrases. It blesses me, it does. But I get blessed when they quote His phrases on there. Because, see, knowing who God is, if you don't know who God is, church, if you don't know who He is, how are you going to know Him when He comes for you? Let me prove my point. I knew what Bill Price looked like. I'd call him. I was sick one day, called him. I like my dad come get me because he had that big Mopar, that big Hemi. You'd hear it come up. And I like riding home in it. But I knew what he looked like. I knew the sound of my dad's voice. I could tell him just talking. I used to know the cologne he wore all the time. You just knew. He'd walk to the house, you know dad had been there. That's how we should be with God. And until you get to that point, you're going to be a shell of what you're supposed to be. I'm not saying you ain't saved, but I'm saying you're an empty vessel that's a child of God that you need to have the whole thing. Getting saved very well gets you there. But who just wants to get there? I like somebody posted on Facebook a while back, and I quoted this one time. I want to go in there sideways, used up. I don't want to go up there reserved, kept everything. I want to go in there sideways, used up for Jesus, man. So who do we say He is? Let me get a couple guitar players up here. There's a song we're going to learn. This old rocker sung it. He's a Christian now, but he looked down the road. He sees somebody coming. He sees somebody coming. If you don't know who He is to you, how are you going to know Him? Like I said, I knew my daddy. He'd get out of the car. That was my daddy. That was my daddy. Everybody else had daddy in school, but that was mine. And I make it personal with Jesus. He's my Jesus. I was standing on the balcony at the hotel, and like I said, I'm looking at that vast body of water. And I was thinking there's going to be a day we're going to walk on that water. There's come the day when the lion's going to lay down with the lamb. There's a whole lot of hell between me and that day. But I thank God for what He's done in my life. I used to love going, and I still love going to the beach. But the whole way down, I said, boy, I miss my baby already. Ain't one of these guys cute enough for me to go hug. I'm kidding. They ain't very cute, but I hug them. But... right? But who do you say He is? And I'm going to ask you one question more. Who do you think He says you are? Can you answer that question? I settled that account a long time ago when I accepted that thing, that salvation, that I know I'm his son. You got to put your name in. I can't do that for you. Who do you say? Let me ask you again. Who does he say you are? Who does he say you are? Father, I've preached what you laid on my heart today, God. I thank you for the safe trip, me and the brothers, Lord. I thank you for keeping your hand up on our families while we were gone, Lord. God, I thank you for the ministry you've laid in my lap. And I'm humbled, God, to minister to your children, Father. But God, I'm asking you, Father, right now, Lord, for all of us, me included, God, there's got to be less of me and more of you. And I ask you to take a greater place in my life. And each person sitting under the sound of my voice, I know that's what they're praying for. Church, I'm going to tell you something. Ask God to search your life with his eyesight. See, we'll wink at things in our life with our eyesight, but God won't. Ask him to search your life and give him permission to remove everything in your life. See, repentance is a turning away from stuff and allowing God to completely cleanse the house. See, you maybe got saved a while back, many years ago maybe, but maybe you haven't been the best housekeeper and you let a lot of things get cluttered up. See, this message is an eternal message because who do you say he is? But the more important question, I'm not preaching on much, is who he says you are. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you're sitting here and you know he won't call you son or daughter, you need to make it right. Because, see, you don't want to wait that day. And he says, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I never knew you. I attended church. I paid tithes. I even helped work in the church. But you never repented and accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. Because someone down your life said you don't have to. You got to believe who he is. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.